Big. We're getting reports that there is a large tornado right behind us here. This is the same cell that is moving through to El Reno. Hopefully everybody listened to the warnings.
I've had two close calls as a storm chaser. It was something historically we as meteorologists have never seen before happen. It was in El Reno, Oklahoma. It turned out to be the largest tornado in history. We knew we had a safe escape route until the storm grew to 4.2 kilometers wide and started to turn toward where our car was. I could see the tornado outside my window, and I've got my camera put out the window, and I'm thinking I'm looking at rain, like a wall of rain. But then I realize as it gets closer that I'm actually looking at the edge of what became the largest tornado ever in U.S. history. That tornado did cross the road right where we were, and it did kill three storm chasers that day. I thought this might be it. You know, I've got a family, I've got a husband, but by the time the next season came around, I was up for it again. I chase tornadoes, I chase hurricanes, I chase winter weather. We just go where the most extreme weather is, and we try and find that story. It starts out as a beautiful clear day. The sun heats the atmosphere and you start to see clouds start to go up. As soon as you're driving into your target zone and you see those clouds start to build up in the atmosphere, and then that hopefully grows into a 60,000 foot topped supercell thunderstorm. I find it fascinating. I think the best way to learn about it is to just put yourself right in it. I've chased seven hurricanes now to date. The strongest hurricane I've chased was Hurricane Michael. It came on shore as a Category 4 hurricane in the Florida Panhandle. We had winds well over 200 kilometers an hour that were sustained where we were. We spent the majority of our time after landfall in Mexico Beach, which was completely washed away with storm surge. The images out of there are just absolutely horrifying.
Hurricane Michael absolutely devastated this area. You can see behind me all of this debris strung around this inlet, kind of an intercoastal. Beyond those big white buildings is actually the main part of the ocean. So we had onshore flow with the right front quadrant of the hurricane. That meant storm surge was the biggest threat in this area, and you can see why, because most of this damage, in fact, probably 90% of the damage we see right here, is not caused by winds, but the piling up of that water.
You never want to be in the track of the storm's motion. So I'm always thinking about an escape route, and I'm thinking about positioning myself in a way that I can see it, but it's moving away from me, or it's moving parallel to me. You never want to be making decisions 20 minutes before the storm is making landfall. By then, the conditions are deteriorating, so if you've not found your safe spot, you're screwed.
I don't want to wimp out on this one. Okay, I want to respect it, I want to be safe, but I am not going to run.
Keep in mind, at this point, you can't run. There's no running. If you run now, you're in far more trouble than if you picked a spot to shelter in the strongest winds.
When you're storm chasing, teamwork is key. If you're out there with someone that's nervous or someone that's just difficult to get along with, you're in for trouble because you literally have to rely on the people that are in your car or in that parking garage when chasing a hurricane to save your life. You have to know that the people you're with can interpret radar data or model data well, because if you screw up, you could be in a dangerous spot. If someone says, no, that's enough, we're too close to the storm, you have to respect that and say, that's close enough for me too. I'm in it for the rush, no question, but I try and do it safely. You don't want a devastating hurricane to anybody that lives there. But as a meteorologist and a storm chaser, they're so massive and so powerful, it's just exciting to me. It's what I live for.